for the very last time. This is her last quiz, her last chance to get perfect. Number one is using the work energy theorem, and I said to you I'm not putting the work energy theorem on your final, but those of you that are signed up for Physics 12 next year, we flog this to death. It's the most useful definition of work, even though it's the biggest pain. So it wants to know how much work. My brain would go like this. My first thought would be, well, I would try force times distance, and then I would say, don't write that down. I don't see a force. I don't see a distance. I would scratch that out in my head. I would also say, well, maybe I can figure out the work from a force versus distance graph. No graph. Only then would I say, okay, the best and most useful definition of work, even though it's also, no pun intended, the most work, is that one there. I would notice that there doesn't seem to be any kind of a hill involved here, and so the work is just going to be the change in potential energy. Logan, if it says stop, what's V final? So what's my final kinetic energy?
Same answer.
And so when I go change in anything is final minus initial, it's going to end up being 0 minus a half m V initial squared. I'm going to cut corners and do this as fast as possible because I want to spend as much time reviewing today as I can. So I'm going to go straight to my calculator. It's going to be negative 0.5 times 950 times 45 squared. You get negative 962,000. I will be fussy. If you don't have the negative, I'm taking a half mark off. The negative is saying the car's got to lose energy. By the way, does anybody here drive a hybrid or an electric vehicle? Your parents drive a hybrid or an electric vehicle? No one here does? Oh, okay. One of the reasons the electric vehicles get such good, I'll call it gas mileage, why they get so much kilometers per charge, is instead of bleeding this off as heat the way standard brakes do, they actually take this energy and they can divert a whole bunch of it into recharging the batteries. It's brilliant. It's a regenerative braking system. And it turns out it's not that difficult. I might show you how it works because it's towards the end of Physics 12. I didn't get to it this year in Physics 12, but I hope to get there next year because it's how electric motors and generators work. So that's one of the other reasons that they get such good gas mileage, if you want to call it that. What's the minimum force? Well, work equals force times distance, so I guess the force of friction is going to be the work done by friction divided by the distance. It's going to be 962,000 divided by 150. You can leave the negative here if you want to. The negative is just telling you it's in the backwards direction, and I should probably have just said the magnitude, but you're going to get 6,410 newtons or 6,400 newtons, one mark. Negative or positive, I don't care. What's the minimum mu? Mu equals friction divided by the normal force, because friction equals mu times the normal force. I don't know the normal force. Oh, but look. I know another force the same size as the normal force. So it's going to be this number here divided by mg. So divided by 950 times 9.8, and lo and behold, I get 0.689. And I'm ignoring the negative because mu doesn't have a direction or units. Having said all that, number one, not on your final exam because that's using the work energy theorem, and I said that lesson 7 because I really hadn't had a chance to assess you properly, not on your final. Question number 2, this is also going to be a work energy theorem question. It's a long question, not on your final exam. It would have been on your unit test, though, and this was fulfilling the promise on Friday. I said to you, finally, I can show you what I talked about way back in October. We started out by going, strangely enough, work equals work. We then said it's going to be force times distance equals the change in potential plus the change in kinetic. We then said no hill, so I can do that. We ended up with 0 minus a half m v initial squared. Where did this 0 come from? Final. What's final velocity, Logan, of any car accident ever? Yeah. And so what's the final kinetic energy of any car accident ever? Yeah. That energy's got to go somewhere. Ideally, we'd like it to go into damaging the car, not damaging the people. Okay? Here, We're going to go force times distance. Which force? Friction. I'm going to crunch the left-hand side. Friction is going to be mu times the normal force. I don't know the normal force. Oh, but look, 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 look. I know another force the same size as the normal force. Oh, we said, wait a minute. What was kind of cool was they didn't need to tell me the mass of the car. Even if it's a hit and run, we don't care. We can still figure out how fast the car was going because the M cancels. And we also said on this line, Antonio, I'm going to chuck the negative because technically this force would be negative because it's backwards. It's in the opposite direction. So I said to you, just ignore the negative. We're going to chuck the negative. And I'm going to get the V by itself. It's going to be times by 2 square root. I ended up with the initial speed being 2 times mu times G times D square rooted. It's going to end up being 2 times mu times 9.8 times the distance square root, and I get 23.7. If you got that, I would give you 3 out of 3. Otherwise, this is really a multi-step question. I would give a half mark if I saw that, a half mark if I saw that, a half mark if I saw that. I would give a half mark if I saw that. That's 2 marks. I would give a half mark if I saw that. That's 2.5 marks. Boy, I'm running up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. I need more marks for this. Anyways, I would give you a half mark for the answer or something like that. To be honest, if this was in Physics 12, this would be a 7-mark question. In Physics 12, most written questions on tests are with 7 marks, and that's so I can just give up part marks like crazy. And then I would turn the page. This is fair game. This is conservation of energy. How do I know? Because there's a change in the height, there's a change in speed, and a yucky curvy path. KE initial plus PE initial equals KE final plus PE final. It says ignore friction, so we're going to ignore heat. We are going to say at the bottom, our final potential energy is 0. I'm going to pretend the ground is right there. They want me to find the final speed at the bottom. It's going to be a half mv initial squared plus mgh initial equals a half mv final squared. The m cancels. You don't have to. Did they give you that mass? They gave you the mass, but for what it's worth, it cancels. And I'm going to go times by 2, times by 2, times by 2. If I do that, I'm going to get 2 VI. No, I'm not going to get 2. Here the 2 and the 1 half are going to cancel. Here the 2 and the 1 half are going to cancel. I'm going to get VI squared plus 2GH initial. That equals VF squared square root. And so it's going to end up being the square root of 8.3. Don't forget the squared. Plus 2 times 9.8 times 21. Square root of that, and I get 21.9 meters per second. Some kind of roller coastery conservation of energy GG question is fair game for your test. So this one would be fair game for your final exam. How much energy was transformed into heat? So I'm going to start over with KE initial plus PE initial equals KE final plus PE final, but now they want me to figure out the heat. Potential final is still 0, so how would I get the heat by itself? I'm going to minus the kinetic energy final over, and I'm going to get this. Heat equals KE initial plus PE initial minus KE final. Heat is going to be a half m v initial squared plus m g h initial minus a half m v final squared. Jackson, how many terms are there in this question? Four. Is there an m in every single term? Yeah, m does not cancel this time. Okay, so I can't do that. Instead, I'm going to plug and chug. I'm running out of room here. I have to write small, Mr. Duick. Heat equals 0.5. What was the mass? 45. 8.3 squared plus 45 times 9.8 times 21 minus 0.5 times 45 times 16 squared. 0.5 times 45, 54. 45 times 8.3 squared plus 45 times 9.8 times 21 minus 0.5 times 45 times 16 squared. Do you get 5,050? Anybody nodding? I see some nods. Are they fake nods? I don't know. And heat is energy, so it's measured in joules. I like number four. I like number four. I like number four. Number four is a nice question. A coaster starts from a standstill at the top of a 90-meter hill. With passengers, the mass of the coaster is 400 kilograms. What's its speed at the bottom? Is there a change in height? Is there a change in speed? Is there a yucky curvy path? This is a job for conservation of energy. And this is a really nice one because we're starting at rest and we're ending up at the bottom. Initially, that's initial and that's final. And so I end up with mgh initial equals a half m V final squared. Mass cancels. Yay! And I end up with V final equaling 2 GH initial or GH initial divided by 0.5 SAM square root. It's going to be, this might work out evenly, 2 times 9.8 times 90 square root. Yeah, 42 meters per second. Is that right, folks, or not? Okay, 2 out of 2 if you got that. B, the top of the next hill is 50 meters high. How fast will the coaster be traveling at the top of the next hill? I'm going to show you a clever shortcut for doing B if you want. You don't have to do it this way. You could let this be initial and you could let this be final. I'm going to do that, but here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to move the ground right to there because I can do that with conservation of energy. I can let zero be wherever I want to, in which case when I write KE initial plus PE initial equals KE final plus PE final, I'm going to pretend that that's the ground right there. Even though it's not, I'm going to just do all my math as though that's the ground, and I'm still starting out at rest. So I'm going to get the same kind of setup. I'm going to get mgh initial equals a half mv final squared, and the m still cancels. In fact, I'm going to get exactly the same equation, except it's going to be 2 times 9.8, not times 90. If I treat this as the ground and this is 90 meters high, what's the height that we've actually dropped in your head? I'll get the same answer as if I did it the longer way. This is going to work out evenly too, 28 meters per second. Or you could have had a final potential energy here, subtract it over, and you would get the same answer if you were very, very careful. Number five, how much work is done? Work is fair game for your final exam, and so that's going to be force times distance. It's going to be 130 newtons times 0.7 meters, not times 70. 91, how much potential energy is stored in the bow? 91 joules, because we've done work. All of that 91 joules is going to turn into a half mv squared. It's going to turn into kinetic. So if I want to figure out how fast the arrow leaves, it's going to be 2 times 91, try that again, Mr. Duick, divided by the mass, which is 0.0186 square root. It's going to leave at 2 times 90, times, Mr. Duick, times 91 divided by 0.0186 square root of that. 98.9, is that right, folks? People nodding? Yep. 98.9 meters per second. Bonus. If the arrow only leaves the bow with a speed of 54, how much did we lose to heat? Well, we would go kinetic initial plus potential initial equals kinetic final plus potential final plus heat. We're starting out at rest. Our initial potential energy was 91 joules. Our final potential energy is zero. I'm going to minus KE final, and that's going to give me heat. And I'm running out of room and I'm rushing. 91 minus a half M. What was the V? 54 squared. We lost 63.9 joules to heat, if you happen to get that. You can give yourself a lovely score out of 23. Some basic stuff. A car accelerates from 60 kilometers per hour to 85 kilometers per hour in 3 seconds. What's its average acceleration in meters per second squared? Why can't I just dive right in here? What's yucky about this? I think, and I said to you, there's not going to be any formal unit conversion on your test. The two that are fair game are kilometers per hour to meters per second and vice versa, and going from seconds to minutes to hours to seconds to minutes to hours. In other words, I can give you time in any of the big three formats. What do we do time with in physics? Seconds. Okay? So I could have given this to you in minutes, except accelerating over a minute would be a really slow acceleration. How do I convert this to kilometers per hour? Well, first of all, what was the method that we used to use? We've gotten away from it, Antonio, as you've gotten more expert, but we had this DFIC thing that I told you about where I would write down A equals question mark, and then I would read the question looking for numbers and units. What's this 60, Antonio? What's it telling me? Which one? So I would write down VI equals 60, and because I don't like the units, I would write kilometers per hour, and I would pause, and I would do the conversion. How do I convert kilometers per hour to meters per second? What, which is what? 16.67? Antonio, what's that 85? Which is what? 23 point. Give it to me to 4 sig figs. And you'll notice if the units match, I'm often lazy. Here I wrote them, but once I'm in good units, I often just didn't care about writing units because I'm tending to abbreviate. Antonia, what's the 3? What's this 3? Yeah, oh, time. Which equation, Antonio? And this is where we started that formula manipulation stuff. Yeah? Get the A by itself. Get the A by itself. If you got a negative acceleration, what was that telling you? Slowing down. Now, sometimes you would have had to insert the negative if the question told you it was slowing down. These are all technically vectors except for time. Velocity is a vector and acceleration is a vector. They have direction and the direction means something. What do you get? This is where you want to be following along on your calculator, and the quicker you are, the quicker we go. Jackson, what'd you get? Okay. Now what'd you get? Roughly 7 divided by 3. So you're going to get really, really close to 2.3 something. Yes. What are the units for acceleration? Okay. So probably I'll give you some kind of question somewhere where the units don't match. Be careful. Oh, and I guarantee I would have the straight 85 minus 60 divided by 3 as an answer to pick from, probably answer A. Savannah's going to shut the door behind her because she has good manners. 8. A motorcycle rider traveling at 35 meters per second collides with a haystack. I just stole these from your final exam review, and I've just changed the numbers, and is brought to rest in a distance of 1.6 meters. What's the acceleration? This answer is going to be wrong. Okay, for part A, what do they want me to find? A equals question mark. What's that 35, folks? VI is 35. What's that 1.6? That's not enough. I need three things to find the fourth. In this unit, in the kinematics unit, every equation had four variables, so I always needed three of them to find the fourth. What else do I know? Yeah. What's VF? Yeah. Good. What equation? And get the A by itself, please.
A equals VF squared minus VI squared.
So it's going to be 0 squared minus... Do I need brackets around the top? Yeah, and I need brackets around the bottom. What do you get? I think you're going to get a negative answer, and you should, because this rider is slowing down. What'd you get? You have to be following along on your calculator. If you're not following along on your calculator, I'm kicking you out. Bare minimum, I said, you know. Where's your calculator? Sorry? Where's your calculator? So you power your phone off. I'm going to loan you one. Yeah. Jackson.
10.9.
Sorry?
10.9.
10.9. Anybody else? That seems low. Is that right? Yeah, that's. I think you forgot the squares or something. That's way too low. What is it?
383
meters per second squared. B says, how many g's of acceleration is this? How do you figure out how many g's when you know the acceleration? Divide by 9.8, or if I tell you the number of g's and I want to convert it to meters per second squared, times by 9.8. How many g's? It's going to be around 38, a little more than 38. So it's going to be 383 divided by 9.8. And that's why we call it g's. You're dividing by the acceleration due to one gravity. What is it? So this particular crash is the same as having 38 people dogpile on him, because all of you right now are feeling 1 g. That's your normal state of affairs. So if you're experiencing 3 g's, mathematically, that's like 2 of you dogpiling on you. If you're experiencing 5 g's, mathematically, that's like 4 of you dogpiling on you. 39 g's. That's like 38 of him dogpiling on himself. Probably broken bones, possibly fatal, but maybe not. It all depends on what part of the body he hits the haystack with and what kind of equipment he's wearing. Generally, anywhere around 20 G's, though, you're not a happy camper. You're hospitalized for a while. Okay. Then we started looking at free fall. Eventually, I jumped out of an airplane. So suppose I drop a rock off a cliff. It hits the water below 12.4 seconds later. What's the height of the cliff? What's this question want me to find? Height. But back then, we called it distance. We hadn't gone all scalar yet. By the way, I couldn't do this with conservation of energy, GG, because time didn't show up in our conservation of energy equations. So I'd have to use this using kinematics. D equals, what's that 12.4? That's only one thing. I need three things. What else do I know? How do I know VI is zero? Okay, that was a trigger word. What else do I know in free fall? A is negative 9. And here we were back in vector land, so it was negative. This is going to give us a negative height because we are going to end up below from where we started. What equation? You wasted my time. What equation? Why didn't he need to read out the VIT? Why could he have just said D equals a half AT squared? What? And I'm just, again, I will never take marks off if you write out the whole thing, but I'm always just trying to teach you, keep an eye out for the zeros. They often make life nicer, yes? So it's going to be 0.5 times negative 9.8 times 12.4 squared. This should be a fairly high cliff because 12 seconds of free fall is a chunk. You'll get a negative answer. Why negative? Because actually this isn't finding the distance, it's finding the displacement, and you did end up below from where you started from, so the negative won't freak me out, it'll make me happy. If I had said height, though, since height is a scalar, if this was multiple choice, the answers to pick from would probably be positive. What do you get? K Kentley, what'd you get? Still typing? Sam, what'd you get?
-753.
753. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Since they said height, I'm going to ditch the minus meters. That's a high cliff. I would not want to be standing on the edge of that. What will the velocity be just before it hits the water? Well, I guess that wants me to find V final. And I think what I would try and do whenever possible is use the data that they gave me. I wouldn't bother rewriting this because it's at the top of the page right there. I could use the distance, but I would try and avoid it if I could. And here I think I can. In fact, here I think it's straight plug and chug. I can go with VF equals VI plus AT. Mr. Duick, you wasted my time. Carlos, you're right. VF equals AT. And that should tell me the final velocity. You'll get a negative answer. Why does the negative answer comfort me and not scare me? Pardon me? No and no. It's nothing to do with ending up below, and I'm not slowing down. This is a velocity, so not an acceleration. Why does the negative not bother me when I get a negative answer? For velocity, what does a negative mean? No, it doesn't mean you're stopping for an acceleration, slowing down, but this is velocity for, pardon me? No, it's velocity. Stop saying acceleration comments. You're way overcomplicating this. What direction am I traveling when I hit the ground? Down, you say. I want a negative velocity. And you get one, yes? Which is what? Anybody? Sorry? Can't be 121. Has to be negative, right? It has to be. It's negative 9.8 times a scalar. It has to be. What'd you get? Negative what? 122? Meters per second. And that negative doesn't freak me out. And I did say velocity. I would not feel bad if I had positive 122 as an answer to pick from on this question. In fact, I would have no problem making it answer A because I said velocity. If I wanted the positive value, what word would I use instead of velocity? No, if I wanted the positive value, what would I have asked you to find instead of velocity? Speed. Speed. Scalar. Speed. Okay. Tennis ball at ground level is launched vertically upwards at 36 meters per second. What's the maximum height above the ground reached by the ball? What's this question you want me to find? Well, let's write that down. D equals question mark. What else do I know? What's VI? VI is zero? I think I disagree. First of all, what's VI? Let's answer the original question. What's VI? Positive or negative? How do you know positive? Okay, if I was standing on a cliff and I threw it downwards, I would have to include a negative for VI. But here, VI is positive. Are you positive? That's only one thing. There must be two more things that I know. What else do I know? Somebody said I know VF. Really? What? Oh, at the top for a split second, VF is going to be zero. What else do I know? What's the acceleration? Even on the way up? Oh, because on the way up, it's slowing down. That would be a negative acceleration. And on the way down, it's speeding up in the negative direction. So a negative acceleration would cause you to speed up in the negative direction. Which equation? And get the D by itself, please. I'll give you a hint. D equals... Did you get a little nerdy adrenaline rush, Ben, when you did that all in your head? I hope you did, because you've earned it. Yeah, it's going to be 0 squared minus 36 squared. Now, I started to get nervous because I said this is going to be negative on the top, and I'm definitely above from where I started, so I want a positive answer. But then when I went all over 2 times negative 9.8, I smiled because now I'm going to get a negative divided by a negative, which is a positive. What'd you get? Okay, I want to see you sitting up and typing. And I don't want to tell you again. I want to see you typing. You did it already? Sorry?
66.1.
66.1? I was hoping it was going to go higher, but maybe not. Okay. What's B asking me to find? Time? Did I already list everything right there? I'm not going to bother rewriting it. How can I find time? Yeah, more specific. What equation? Get the t by itself, please. I'll give you a hint. T equals... Okay, minus vi over a. If I had extra time, no pun intended, I could also probably use this d. I think I can also use d equals vi t plus a half a t squared to find time, although that one might be a quadratic. But if I got the same answer both ways, then I would know I had everything right. But that one would be a yucky quadratic. I'd use a quadratic solver if I had one. Hopefully you listened to me and got a decent calculator and have a quadratic solver, because that's going to come in handy next year, those get signed up. Anyways, I'm going to get 0 minus 36 all over negative 9.8. 3 point what? 3.6? Can you give it to me? Three sig figs, please. 3.67? Is that rounded off properly?
Yeah.
Seconds. What's the total flight time of the ball? You can find it two ways. You can take your answer from B and double it, and that's because we're starting on the ground and ending on the ground, and what goes up must come down, and I can just double it. If you hadn't done part B already, it's called an attention span, and they had just asked for part C and you hadn't done part B, you could have been clever by answering, what's the impact velocity? What's V final? Don't say zero. That's after it hits the ground. What's V final? Sorry? Loud and proud, Adam. Negative 36. I can move this way, way higher right to here. And you could have said V final is negative 36 because what goes up must come. Now, that only works if you're not standing on a cliff. Okay? But then you could have used V final, V initial, and A and found T in one step without going times by two. I don't care which method you use. Just always nice to have a couple of different methods and get the same answer for both. A ball is dropped from a height of... You know what? I think I can do this, Mr. Duick. Insert space. Ooh, technology. There. Save some paper. A ball is dropped from a height of 124 meters. How much time does it take until it hits the ground? Well, I guess this question's asking me to find time. Dropped. What's VI? What's A? What's D? Don't say 124 because that's wrong. Here we had to bring in the fact that actually this wasn't a distance. It was a displacement. It was a vector. All of these are vectors except for time. Time is a scalar. By the way, there will be one multiple choice question where I either give you a list of three vectors and one scalar and say which one's the scalar, or I give you a list of three scalars and one vector and say which one's the vector. That part of things you do have to memorize because the rules are different for both for them, especially next year. How would I find t? First of all, which equation am I going to use? Let's start there. D equals AT squared over 2. What happened to the VIT? 0. And then instead of writing a 1 half, I just put it over 2. Now get the T by itself. How will I move the A over? How will I move the 2 over? So you're going to get 2 times D over A. That equals T squared. Talk to me, people. Yeah. Which is what? Now, the nice thing here is if you forget to make D negative, you'll get an error on your calculator. My calculator says non-real answer. In fact, my calculator, I like to think, says get real, because you're saying that you accelerated down but ended up above from where you started from. That ain't happening, so go fix it. 5.03, anybody else? What's the impact velocity of the ball? Isn't it zero? No. That's after it hits the ground. What's the V final impact velocity? That's what it wants me to find, V final. I could use time, and I could go VF equals VI plus AT, straight plug and chug. Just do that on your calculator for starters. Can you go VF equals VI plus A times T? Using your answer button, what do you get? You don't need to do the zero plus people, so it should have just been negative 9.8 times answer button. Negative 49 meters per second. And I would give you full credit, but you know I don't like using an answer to find an answer. What equation could I have used to find V final that uses VI, A, and D in it? Yeah, the other thing I could have done is I could have gone VF squared equals VI squared plus 2A. D cross out the squared square root. Oh, and VI is zero. But if you try typing this into your calculator, you're going to notice a small issue. So can you go 2 times negative 9.8 times negative 124, hit equals, and then go square root of that? You're going to see there's a problem. Your calculator assumes here you want the positive square root, which, let's be honest, in math, you almost always do. And most of the time we do in physics, but not this time. So you're going to have to introduce yourself that negative. And then you get 49 meters per second. That's the weakness with this equation. When you square things, you lose a negative sometimes. And so you'll have to, when you square root, analyze the question, Riley, and figure it out. Is that okay? Special relativity. We started out first looking at relative speed. What was relative speed? If you had two objects moving at different speeds, this was a job for relative speed. So the police are chasing a car which is 240 meters ahead and going 110 kilometers per hour. If the police are going to catch up to the car in 24 seconds, you know, I'm going to change this just to keep it nicer. Let's make this meters per second, and I'm going to cross this out, and I'm going to make it meters per second. 110 meters per second, divide. Yeah, it's about 26 meters per second. So how fast do the police have to go in meters per second if they want to catch up to the bad guys in 24 seconds? Well, what's this question asking me to find? It wants me to find their speed. Is there more than one object? Say yes. Are they traveling at different speeds? Say yes. Then I'm going to find VREL. Who remembers for relative speed, for the whole relativity unit, what was acceleration always? Yeah, in fact, it took Einstein 10 years to work in. We called it special relativity. Really, it should be called special case relativity. What's the special case? A is zero because Einstein didn't know how to deal with acceleration yet. So A is going to be zero. Kenley, what's that 240? What's that 24? Is there an equation that has A and D and T and V in it? There is one. This one. Except what's A? And instead of VI, because we have more than one object moving, we've tweaked it. That's where we're going to put the relative speed. How would I get the V by itself? So I'm going to get D over T by a fluke just because I was making up numbers. This is going to work. Why did I write 240 there? Or was that supposed to be a messy S? That might have been a messy S. I can't remember. It's going to be 240 divided by 24. Do you all get VREL equals 10, yes? Now, that doesn't mean that the police car is going 10 meters per second. That's how fast the police car have to go if the bad guys are standing still. How fast are the bad guys going? Sorry? Then this is how much faster the police have to go. The police is going to be 10 plus 26. The police have to go 36 meters per second to overcome the bad guys, 26 meters per second. And I think I said to you, if you reverse this backwards, so that 26 is how fast the bad guys are going. If you reverse this, this is how radar detectors work. Radar detectors know how fast the police car is going. They know how long the time takes for the light to bounce back and forth, and they work their way backwards and figure out how fast you must be going and whether or not you get a ticket, for what it's worth. Or, of course, the moral of the story is just don't speed. How long until the two trains completely pass each other? Is there more than one object in this question? Are they traveling at different speeds? We're going to be using relative speed. So they want me to find time. And our argument for them to pass each other, we said the back end of this train has to pass the back end of that train. sorry, I guess the front end of that train. What's the total distance that this back train needs to travel relative to this front train? Well, I think it's going to be 150 plus 840 plus 100, which is what? 1090? And we're going to use relative speed. They're both going in the same direction. One's going 18, one's going 11. What's our relative speed? Looking for an equation that has a t. Oh, and we said that a was always equal to 0. So again, I can use d equals v relative times t plus a half at squared. But Rowan, what's a? So I didn't bother writing plus a half at squared. How would I get the t by itself, Rowan? So it's going to be 1,090 divided by 7. This won't work out evenly unless it's by a fluke. 156, if I go to 3 sig figs, let's say. Seconds. Right around 2.5 minutes. We could also have them coming towards each other. Same argument for train number one to pass train number two. The back end of this train has to pass the back end of this train. And so I'm going to argue that the total distance that we're talking about, well, first of all, they want time. The total distance that we're talking about is 120 plus 516 plus 80, which is what? 716 meters. What about, what's VREL when you're heading towards each other? We add them together, 15 meters per second. And now it's the same question, Rowan, as before. It's going to be D equals VT. And so T is going to be D over V. It's going to be 716 divided by 15. 47.7. That was our introduction to relative speeds, and we said that when objects are moving towards each other, you add the speeds together. When objects are moving away from each other, you add the speeds together. When they're moving in the same direction, you go bigger minus smaller. But then we found this strange exception that didn't behave that way. What was the one exception in the universe that didn't behave that way at all, that always demanded to get the same answer when you measured its speed, no matter what? What was special? It starts with letter L. Yeah, light, not light, you just light. Light, you'll always get the same measurement for its speed, whether you're moving towards the object, whether you're moving away from the object, whether you're moving in the same direction of the object. All of this V relative that we did with these trains, it breaks down with light. And we said, well, what that means is if you're always going to get the same speed, weird stuff has to be going on with D and T, space-time. So a spaceship travels at 0.96 C for 25 years ship time. How much time will pass on the Earth? I think we're using the time dilation equation, which is on the back of your green sheet. Time on Earth, was that T or T zero? Which one was time on board the spaceship? Oh, that's how I remembered it. I remembered that T zero is time on board the spaceship. So that means they want me to find just plain old T. What's the speed? Well, it's 0.96 C. What equation am I going to use? I'm going to use my time dilation. Jabber, can you show if Matt hasn't found where we are? Have you done a little special relativity? This was really cool. This is time travel. It's legitimate. What's the equation that has the T by itself? Is that the one that I gave you, or do you have to rewrite it? So what is it? T equals what? T zero over? And then I think I told you that sometimes we abbreviate that square root thing with that symbol because it showed up in all of the special relativity equations. So I'm going to tend to a brief. So it's going to be 25 all over the square root of 1 minus 0.96 C over C squared. Do you see? Do you see? Do you see? What do you see? We said if we enter the numbers as a percentage of C, the C's cancel, which is nice. And so you're all going to get your calculators out and try typing this in. And And if you do that, you should get 89.3 years, but double check me. If you're not getting 89.3, you need to make sure you pop in during a flex and I can walk you through how to figure out your calculator again. The proper abbreviation for years was A for annually, because the letter Y is yards in the U.S., because they took that letter first stupidly. This is, I think, fact, this is the question where we found that it was possible for an astronaut to have a small child back home on Earth and come back and be younger than their own child. In fact, their child would have aged 89.3 years. How many years did the astronaut age? 25 years. So if this astronaut left at age 25, how old is the astronaut when they come back home in terms of their years? 50. And how old is their five-year-old child? Whatever 89.3 plus 5 is, that's what they were getting at, for example, in the movie Interstellar, except there the time shifts were caused by gravity and general relativity, not by special relativity. But absolutely, this is totally fair game. Time travel into the future, easy peasy. Because this astronaut would have traveled 89.3 minus 25 that many years into their child's future. Easy peasy. What if we want to find out how much time has passed on board the spaceship? And the number got crossed out. There it is. A spaceship is traveling at 99% of the speed of light. It's gone for 80 years, as measured by those living on Earth. How much time has passed on the spaceship? What's this question asking me to find? Which is going to be, how would you get the T0 by itself? Time times the gamma function. So time is going to be 80 times 1 minus 0.99c over c all squared. Do you see? Do you see? Do you see? What do you see? And so it's going to be 80 times the square root of, times the square root of bracket 1 minus 0.99 squared. And again, we broke this up into chunks when we did this. I'm cutting corners here and doing this in one step. 11.3 years. Astronaut would have experienced 11.3 years. We would have experienced 80 years. And again, there's no fancy schmancy math. That's how the universe actually works. A spaceship has been gone for 100 years spaceship time. The people on Earth measure the time that the spaceship was away to be 250 years. How fast was the ship traveling? Give your answer in meters per second. Which equation are we going to use here? Well, you're solving for V, so which equation are we going to use here, Jackson? I'll give you a hint. V equals can I do it that way? TO over T all squared. Okay. So it's going to be, now, if they wanted me to leave this as a percentage of the speed of light, I would just rewrite the C. If they want it in meters per second, I replace C with its number. What's C as a number? That's also, I think, somewhere there on your green sheet in that same section. Is it 3 times 10 to the 8th? And then square root of 1 minus T on board 100 over 250 all squared. Here, I would probably go 1 minus 100 over 250 all squared. I would do what's inside the square root first. Then I would go square root answer button times 3 times 10 to the 8th. You'd have to be going 91.65% of the speed of light, or in meters per second. 2.75 times 10 to the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Seven or eight? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, Mr. Duick. Meters per second. Yeah, nearly the speed of light, because 3 times 10 to the 8th is the speed of light. Then we also took a brief look at masses and lengths. So suppose a 55-kilogram rock is accelerated to 97% of the speed of light. What would the mass be? I don't remember. Sam, what's my mass equation? Wait a minute. Sam, is this asking me to find M0 or M? So now we need to remember for time. Time zero was on board the spaceship. M0 was the original mass at rest. Which of these is the original mass at rest? 5 something with a kilograms next to it. 9.5. That's a 55 in my hideous writing. And I'm not mad that you can't read my writing, but that's where I tucked it in. And this is the original mass at rest. How do I know? Because it says, what would the mass be at this speed? Clearly, that's not the rest mass. Okay? So this is asking me to find M. Did I give you the equation with the M by itself or not?
Yeah.
I did? Okay, Sam, what's the equation? I'll give you a hint. M equals?
Mass on board
M original, M zero, yeah.
Over 1 minus.
Over? Gamma function?
Oh, yeah.
Is that right, folks? Okay. So it's going to be 55 divided by the square root of 1 minus 0.97 C over C all squared. Do you see? Do you see? Do you see? Yes, I see. 55 divided by square root bracket 1 minus 0.97 squared. And I get that it's measured mass at speed will be 226.2, I'll go 226 kilograms. So as you speed up, as an object speeds up, what happens to its mass? Now, I got to be fussy. In real life, its mass actually isn't increasing. Its inertia is increasing. And the number that you'll have to put in for the conservation of energy equations, where the M goes, is increasing. But it's a complicated situation. It's actually absorbing energy, like E equals MC squared, and it's converting that energy to mass. Hashtag nerd trivia. Also, weird stuff went on with lengths. A 43-meter-long asteroid is shot past a stationary space station. What length do the people on board measure the asteroid to be? This is asking me to find the length. Is this asking me to find the original length at rest? Or is this asking me to find the length that we see when it's moving? So this is asking me to find L. Blake, can you give me the L equals equation, please? I got that part okay. Keep going. I'll give you a hint. L equals. Can you help him out, Jackson? Show him where we're looking. L0 or LO? Yep. Is it times the square root or divided by the square root? Which one? Times? Okay. I don't remember these. I could derive them if I had to, but it's on my sheet. So it's going to be L original 43 times the square root of 1 minus 0.95 C over C all squared. Blake, do you see? Do you see? Do you see? What do you see? The C's cancel. So we're going to get 43 times the square root of 1 minus 0.95 squared. And I get 13.4. Yeah, lengths get shorter as the objects move faster. The relativistic length gets shorter, even though still it's 43 meters long. Moving, we would measure it to be, at that speed, 13.4 meters long. And there's no way for us to say that it's not. In our universe, that's exactly how it would behave. It's all relative. What speed would an object have to travel to increase its mass from 4 to 12? Give your answer as a percentage of the speed of light and in meters per second. Kenzie, what's the question asking us to find? Well, speed. What do they give me? Times, masses, or lengths? Can you read me the speed equation with masses in it, please? I think there's a C in the front. But I can't remember the rest. Yeah, I got that part. Yeah. Divided by? Times or divided by? Help. Times?
The square root of 1 minus.
Keep reading. Sorry?
M0 over M?
Squared? Okay.
Well, let's do it as a percentage first. Let's leave the C as a C. It's going to be the square root of 1 minus M0. The original length is 4. The new, sorry, mass is 4. The new mass is 12. So it's going to be square root of 1 minus bracket 4 divided by 12. 12, Mr. Duick. Squared.
Do you get 0.9428? Calculator. Do you get 94.3% of the speed of light? Okay.
So 0.943 is 94.3% of C.
What does the word of mean in math always, unless it's to the power of? What does it mean every other place in math? Of means? Multiply. So if I want to change this into meters per second, I take that percentage times the actual value of C, which is from your formula sheet, 3 times 10 to the 8th, and now I've got the speed in meters per second, 2.83 times 10 to the 7th. I'm going to pause here because I'm losing too many of you. I was going to get to one more, but we'll probably tackle that next class. That should be enough, though, for you to get a good head start on relativity and kinematics on the review.